We're here with John David Ebert. John, thank you very much for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
John, tell the audience what you do and who you are. There's seems to me like you have a lot of different titles and you wear many hats. So, in your words, who is John David Ebert?
Well, you can put all those hats probably under the one rubric of cultural critic. That would probably fit the best and encompass everything. My interests are admittedly extremely diverse. I started out back in the 90s working for the Joseph Campbell Foundation. So I started out with a background in the study of ritual, symbol, and myth. That was sort of my specialty going into all this stuff. But over the years, you know, I reached this sort of saturation point with that study. It didn't seem to me, you know, it seemed to me I reached a point where I'd read everything on mythology that I could find and that nobody was writing anything new about it. So I reached the point where I realized I was going up a dead end street because I think myth studies as a field is largely a done deal. So I started moving into philosophy and looking at types of philosophy that emerged especially out of German philosophy. My main area of specialization, as it were, in philosophy is German philosophy, especially like Schopenhauer and Nietzsche and Heidegger and Spengler and all of these great German geniuses that I've tried in however rough a fashion to model myself after. So cultural critic, and then so what I do is I write these books that each book looks at contemporary society, the world we're living in today, from a different angle. And all of it is like chapters in a large opus, each chapter of which examines this society in terms of how it relates, how it's doing in terms of its dialogue with ancient civilization. That's how I would put it.
So where does it all start? Does it start from Sumeria, from Egypt?
It does. It does. Often, you know, the typical cliche is that, you know, the West begins with the Greeks. That's how it is in Heidegger. That's how it is in a lot of art history books and so forth. You start with this ancient medieval modern schema. And indeed, the Greeks did form most of the basic ideas of our civilization in origin. But the problem with that is that behind the Greeks, and the ancients all along, especially since the Renaissance, some of them sensed this, that there lay the shadow of Egypt behind Greece. And that a lot of what the Greeks did, especially you can see this in their early sculptures, which are clearly modeled after Egyptian sculpture, and they inherited geometry as well from the Egyptians. And they regarded the Egyptians as the great archaic civilization, the mother spring of civilization. And the same way that our Renaissance people in Florence regarded the Greeks themselves as the great mother culture of the West. And then, of course, back behind the Egyptians lay the Mesopotamians, the earliest group of which is the Sumerians, who come into being around somewhere in the middle of the 4th millennium, about 3500 BC. And they begin to get going, and they run through a culture cycle that starts running out of gas along about 2500 BC. So after about 1,000 years, that is about the period when Gilgamesh, the actual historical king, the real Gilgamesh, lived, right about 2600 BC, and he was the king of the city of Uruk. And then it runs out of gas and it declines and falls apart into civil war, and so that by the time you get to about the year 2100, you have what's known as the third dynasty of Ur, where all their culture is entirely backward-looking, and they are harvesting and collecting all of their myths, and for the first time, committing all of them to writing. And it's out of that period right there that we get the Gilgamesh epic, or at least some of the earliest Gilgamesh stories anyway. The Sumerian Gilgamesh stories are harvested right at that time. And then after them comes the Babylonians, long about 1700 BC with Hammurabi. And the Babylonians basically took over and copied Sumerian culture the same way the Romans took over and copied Greek culture, basically. They looked up to the Sumerians, and so they adopted Gilgamesh, and at some point they put the Sumerian Gilgamesh tales together to create an epic. In Sumer, the Gilgamesh epic had not ever existed as an epic with chapters. It was a series of random, disconnected episodes. But the Babylonians were the first to see in it an epic, and they put it together as an epic, and in many ways it becomes the West's first great literary epic. And it, you know, this is long before Homer. So I think we have to look there at Gilgamesh for the origins of the beginning of the development in the West that's still taking place now.
So how does the Epic of Gilgamesh relate to the new media?
It doesn't relate to it in a direct way, except insofar as that it, the archetype of the journey of the solar hero who sets off on a quest, and in this case Gilgamesh goes through the cosmos. He actually, it's written out on 12 tablets, and it's a story about how he goes through the 12 different signs of the zodiac, and he encounters these characters like the scorpion men that he encounters are actually the sign of Scorpio. And the water bearer, Aquarius, turns up as Utnapishtim, the old flood hero survival, who has survived from a previous world age when the flood wiped civilization out. And that was 25,000 years earlier than Gilgamesh's time, at least in myth time, not in historical time. And that's the sign of Aquarius. He's the lord of the watery abyss, and he is Gilgamesh's teacher. But the basic archetype of the story of the solar hero, this aggressive, macho, jock hero who's used to fighting lions and wrestling, has to undergo a process whereby he gets initiated into the spiritual mysteries of the universe, and those are beyond just merely the physical plane. And that process, basically that myth underlies a lot of what we get in today's Hollywood movies, where the Gilgamesh story is replayed again and again in films like Star Wars and in a lot of the science fiction space epics, Chronicles of Riddick and so forth. A lot of that is reworking the same mythology that began with Gilgamesh.
Well, let's talk about the Epic of Gilgamesh in a little bit more detail. What is exactly permeating through society from the Epic of Gilgamesh?
Well, first let's look at the story.
Okay.
The story is about a king of the city of Uruk, and the city of Uruk is one of the oldest cities in the world, and it is the city in which writing actually was invented. We have this documented concretely back in about 3500 B.C. So we're in 2600 B.C. With Gilgamesh here, and he's the king of the city, and he is taking advantage of all the women in the city who are just getting married, and he is pushing aside the bridegrooms and sleeping with the women on the first night, basically. And so the men of the city get together. They're not happy about this, and they pray to the gods to send a warrior who will put Gilgamesh in his place. And so what the gods do is they send this creature known as Enkidu, and he's basically a wild man who comes in from the deserts, from the steppe land, and he's out there, out beyond the pale of the city, trapping animals, living off the land, and he comes into conflict with a hunter who then complains about him, and the hunter goes back to the city and brings a prostitute out to meet him. The prostitute has sex with him, and from that point on, it seems to civilize him. It tames him, basically. And the prostitute leads Enkidu back then to the city. So he migrates into Uruk. So now we have the ancient story of man's migration from the countryside and nature into an urban mode of being. And so when he encounters Gilgamesh, he fights him. He challenges him to a fight. The two get into a wrestling match, and neither one of them can best the other. So as the result of that, they become best friends. And the first thing they do is they want to decide to go out and do some great heroic mission that will make their names live on forever. So they decide to take an expedition up the Euphrates to go to the cedar forest in Lebanon, where they cut down the great cedar tree. This is the cosmic world axis, the linchpin that holds the cosmos together. And in order to cut it down, they first have to fight a fierce creature named Humbaba, who is the guardian of the forest. They kill him, they cut down the tree, they carve up its lumber, they put it all onto rafts, and they send the rafts going back down the Euphrates all the way back down to Uruk, which is located near the Persian Gulf. And they get on it and go back. And as he comes back, as Gilgamesh is coming back out, the main priestess of the Inanna cult sees him. In some of the versions of the story, it's actually the goddess Inanna herself, who was the great goddess of the city of Uruk, one of the main cults of the city. Was devoted to her. She was associated with the planet Venus, and she had a whole astronomical cult associated with her. She sees him coming back, and she's a little bit turned on by his machismo, and she asks him, she demands that he marry her. And he refuses, and not only does he refuse, he humiliates her, and as the result of that, she goes up to heaven to her father, who happens to be the sky god On. And she says, Gilgamesh needs to be punished, and what can we do about this? And she demands that he send Taurus, the constellation of the great bull, down to the earth to punish him. So Taurus descends to the earth, and it launches an assault. We can imagine it as a sort of giant, like a monster out of a 1950s B-movie. It assaults the city, crashes through the walls, and Gilgamesh and Enkidu go out, and they basically perform the world's first bowl slaying. They make mincemeat out of it, tear it apart, and they throw its thigh up to Inanna, and they mock her, basically, and she feels completely humiliated. So as a result of this humiliation, she decides to have Enkidu punished, and she prays to the gods that he will die of a slow, horrible, wasting disease. And this is what happens to Enkidu. He is this great warrior, and he dies of this slow, AIDS-like disease. And Gilgamesh grieves for him, and the death of Enkidu so upsets him, and he can't get over it, that he decides to leave the city of Uruk behind and to travel out into the wilderness to go in search of immortality. He doesn't want to die like Enkidu. He wants to become immortal, and he wants to know how he can literally, physically become immortal. So he sets off down the Persian Gulf, gets on a ship, he encounters some lions, he kills these lions. That's the astrological sign of Leo, actually worked into the text as we had Taurus. And he sails for a while until he comes to the edge of the world, where he encounters a couple of scorpion men. They represent the constellation of Scorpio. And they let him pass, and eventually he gets to the island of Bahrain, which in those days was known as Dilmun, in quest of the great flood survivor, the man who had survived from the previous wiping out of the world by the great flood 25,000 years earlier. And he goes and he meets this man whose name is Utnapishtim. He's actually Aquarius, the water bearer. And he tells him that he wants to learn about how to achieve immortality. And Utnapishtim tells him, well, it's not an easy thing. And he counts to him what happened, how the gods saved Utnapishtim from the flood, and tells him the flood myth. And then he says, if you want to attain immortality, Gilgamesh, you can't do it through slaying monsters and chasing women around. The only way you can do it is by sitting in a shamanic state and trying to remain awake for 7 days in a row. So he gives him a kind of a yogic task that he knows he probably won't succeed in doing, because after all, he's a sort of jock warrior hero. And of course, he can't do it, and so he's about to leave in failure when Utnapishtim's wife says, we'll give him at least something. And so Utnapishtim relents and says, okay, I will tell you where there is a plant of immortality that you can go. And it won't make you immortal, but it will make you forever young. It'll keep regressing your age so that you won't age. And he tells him where to find it. So Gilgamesh goes, gets on his boat, goes out into the Persian Gulf, and he finds it, goes down into the water, dives, finds the plant, pulls it up, goes back up to his boat, and he's drying off as he lets the plant sit there on the boat, dry off with him. And while he's not looking, a snake climbs up onto the boat, eats the plant. And this is why the snake sheds its skin, because it's eaten this plant of immortality. And so Gilgamesh fails, and he returns back to the city of Uruk, chastened and humbled by his journeys, and he builds the great wall surrounding Uruk, and he becomes the king of Uruk. Now, one of the significances of the story is that Gilgamesh became the Lord of the Dead. There was a death cult associated with him. And it was thought by the Babylonians that he went down into the underworld and he became the Hades figure there, the great lord of the dead. And I think what's going on in the story is that he's been initiated into the secrets of the cosmos through traveling through the 12 signs of the zodiac in order to be the great lord of the dead. In order to be lord of the dead, he has to know the cosmos in its entirety, not just the surface world above, but he also has to know about the underworld and its dark mysteries and its secrets. So the whole story was an initiation to prepare him for becoming the judge of the dead in the underworld. And that's the story in a nutshell. So now you know.
In an interview, you were quoted as saying, myth is the grammar of the psyche. Can you expand on that?
Yes, myth is it is the ancient grammar of the psyche. All the civilizations came into being out of a primarily, originally mythological mode of consciousness. And they inevitably evolve into a philosophical mode, and the philosophical mode at some point gives birth to the sciences, and then you get a cultural disintegration and collapse. So there's this basic cycle that all civilizations go through, and myth is the earliest and oldest way of teaching. Back before literacy, myth was the only way anybody learned anything. In oral traditions, they had to learn stories, as in the case of Homer, where he's just writing down these epics that have been passed down by word of mouth from bards that had to learn them, and they recited them. And that was not only the entertainment, the movies, as it were, of oral societies, but it also had a pedagogical content. It taught the people about what their understanding of being was, what it meant to be, say, a Sumerian or an Egyptian or a Greek. And the myth taught them that. And so myth, though, often, even when a society evolves in its later phases, when you get to a philosophical phase, as our society went through philosophical and a scientific phase, a lot of the theories that scientists will spend forth will actually contain mythological structures in them still, because that's the way the psyche thinks, especially when we're dealing with macrocosmic processes, like, say, the origin of the universe. And, you know, the official scientific myth is that the universe came into being as the result of a singularity, kind of like a black hole that erupted in reverse. It just spat everything out, all this matter, all this energy. Basically, that's a myth, and it's the same thing as the myth of the ancient myth of the cosmic egg that hatches, and from out of it, all the creatures of creation come into being. It's a mythic structure, see, because we can never go back and verify what really did happen at that point. And because the psyche demands totality, the human psyche always wants to go in and compose a complete picture of the cosmos and what happened. Myth rushes in to fill in the gaps in the grammar. It fills it in with these mythological theories that oftentimes will be presented as science, but they're really mythology in disguise. James Hillman in his book, Revisioning Psychology, talks about this a lot, where he talks about, he says, there are gods in our ideas. For example, he says that the Darwinian theory of evolution is really a disguised version of the myth of the great mother goddess and her dying and reviving plant god son. Or he says that the myth of sleeping, the fairy tale of Sleeping Beauty, where the girl has to be awakened with a kiss, is really the psychological theory of the mind beginning as a tabula rasa, a blank slate that experience calls forth and awakens into action. And so myth does indeed appear to be the grammar of the psyche, and it structures a lot of scientific narratives. And most scientists, because they haven't studied mythology, very often will not be aware of this. Some are, but most are not.
Are you saying then that myth somehow influences science?
It does influence science, especially when it comes to the large-scale cosmological aspects of science, or when we're asking about, say, the origins of life on Earth. There tend to be two explanations for the origins of life on Earth, for example. The one is that it emerged from out of the depths of the ocean in these vents, these deep vents in the bottom of the ocean, where these early thermoplasmic bacteria, fermenting bacteria, suddenly spontaneously emerged into being, and eventually they made their way up to the surface where they began spawning and mutating other forms of bacteria, and everything evolved out of that. The mythic structure there, though, is the idea of emergence from the underworld, and it's interesting because all the Native American traditions, especially those of the Southwest, the American Southwest, all say that human beings came into this world from a world down below. They all emerged out of a world beneath the earth and climbed up into this world. So that's a mythic structure there, as is the opposite version of the creation of life on Earth, where you get the idea that it might have come to the earth from outer space in the form of meteorites bringing amino acids with them.
Panspermia theory, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And that's simply the myth of creation from above that we get on the first page of the book of Genesis, where God hovers above the brooding abyss as the great spirit that gets ready to impregnate it. That's a mythic structure, too.
Heaven and hell.
Exactly right.
We'll be back with John David Ebert. We're back with John David Ebert. John, in your second book, Celluloid Heroes and Mechanical Dragons, you talk about mythologies in that book and how they integrate with, you know, the modern society. Would you like to talk about that?
Yeah, I'd love to. That book was written out of two reasons I wrote it. Was one, movies have tended to be my favorite medium. After all, being raised in an electronic society that's slowly becoming disliterate and even illiterate, movies are kind of filling that gap. And so, you know, and I was raised in Phoenix, Arizona, where it's just this worldless suburb where there's nothing to do. There's no culture or civilization at all. And so movies are what I was raised on. And so my love for film, especially, you know, the films of the 70s and 80s, Stanley Kubrick and Steven Spielberg and all that, I wanted to write a book that examined all that stuff, but it also seemed to me to be necessary to write about a major theme that recurs in all of these films, which has to do with the problem of technology. Again and again and again, ever since, at least since 2001, A Space Odyssey came out in 1968, the great Stanley Kubrick film, This theme of technology and the battle against the machine has been reiterated again and again in film after film, James Cameron's Terminator movies to the Star Wars films, to films like David Cronenberg's The Fly. All of these films deal with the wrestle with the machine. And so I gradually began to realize that what contemporary mythology is doing today is that our contemporary myths are in these films. They serve as a modern mythology in which what they're doing is they're relating these archaic story patterns, like such as the Gilgamesh epic, to the problem now of a changed environment. The ancients didn't have the kind of trouble with technology that we have, and they weren't surrounded and engulfed and swallowed up by technology the way we are. So they had different problems that the myths attempted to resolve. In our case, we've sort of fallen. We're captured into the belly of the machine. It determines everything we do today, and the psyche has trouble with it. And you can tell that by the fact that these films are constantly reiterating this obsessive problem of being stalked and chased and destroyed by machine. And very often, whereas in ancient mythology, you got these giant dragons and giants that heroes had to fight, nowadays those giants and dragons tend to be mechanical. They're actually visualized more often than not as these huge robots that have to be fought and slain. And that is the way that the contemporary troubled psyche is trying to work out the problem of its having to adapt to a very artificial, very uncomfortable, highly over-mechanized environment that the psyche never quite, especially the subliminal psyche, the unconscious dream psyche, never quite feels fully comfortable with. And so it announces to the conscious mind its discomfort by dramatizing the subliminal awareness of the pressures that these machines are exerting on it by dramatizing it in the form of these narratives, that we're being invaded by armies of robots. And so that's the dragon to be slain. And that's
just like our dreams.
Yeah. And that's I sort of saw these films as sort of cultural dreams. It's as though when we go into these theaters, we're going into a sort of public auditorium where we're checking in to see what the cultural mind is dreaming about right now. And if you go into the auditorium, whatever movies that you see that are playing in there will tell you what the collective mind of our society as a whole is preoccupied with at the present time.
Dumb and Dumber.
Well, I mean, that's just comic relief. Like, for example, you get the Greeks doing the three great tragedies, and then they always ended with comic relief with a satyr play to lighten the mood. I mean, that's just pure release of tension. Nothing thematic there, I don't think. But, some comedies do have wonderful thematic material in them. Like, for example, Groundhog Day with Bill Murray, I thought was a wonderful handling of the Buddhist idea of reincarnation, and that you're not gonna attain nirvana or release until you get the karma worked out. He has to keep coming back again and again until he gets it right. That he has to learn how to treat other people right, and that's the real goal, not him impressing everybody with his ego.
Stanley Kubrick. Now, I think we could spend quite a bit of time, and I got you here. Why not? In all of Stanley Kubrick's films, they're heavily reliant on myth.
Well, my three favorites are 2001: A Space Odyssey, and A Clockwork Orange, and The Shining.
I want to say, by the way, Eyes Wide Shut, the most underrated Stanley Kubrick movie there is.
It is. I think it got it got beat up a lot when it came out. I think a lot of people were expecting this work of utter genius that would be on the same plane as those other films, but I don't see how you can top films like Dr. Strangelove and 2001 and The Clockwork Orange. You're just not going to do it. Those are that's as good as film gets. And so, Eyes Wide Shut is it's a very good film, but it does have some weak spots in it that his other films tend not to have. Like, for example, I think that part of the problem with the film in the end is that, the scene where it's about a 10 or 15 minute scene where Sidney Pollack and Tom Cruise are discoursing over the pool table, and Sidney Pollack is explaining to him everything that he just went through, why he went through it, who this cult was. And I thought that seemed uncharacteristically Kubrickian to try to explain away all the mystery of the previous scenes with a rational explanation. I think that should be left up to the viewer, and that's exactly why, for example, 2001 works so well. He doesn't tell you what the monolith is. He doesn't tell you who these aliens are or what they're doing, and that's one of the reasons why that's such a great film. He leaves it up to the audience to figure that out for themselves. So I think that's some of the problems I have with Eyes Wide Shut. It's a little bit too rational. Even though that wonderful sequence in the middle with the sex cult and those marvelous scenes with the masks and the ritual in that room is
yeah, that's intense.
That's vintage Kubrick, yeah.
Yeah. What are the Stanley Kubrick movies that embody some of this mythological undertone?
Well, 2001: A Space Odyssey, especially because it deals with, and it's really the first film that kicks off this whole problem with technology and spending a lot of money on the special effects. 2001 was really the first film to take the genre of science fiction seriously and spend a lot of money on the special effects to get them to look convincing to the eye. Because prior to that, the science fiction films in the 1950s and the early 60s are pretty schlocky stuff. They're B-movies, and they were thought to be just suitable for drive-ins. So they didn't spend a lot. The budgets were small, and they didn't spend much money on the spaceships. You can sort of see the wires. It's awful. But Kubrick was the first one to say, well, what if we took this seriously? And we spent all this money on these special effects, and we get them to look so that it's absolutely convincing to the eye. And the thematic material then of the film becomes the process of the evolution of human consciousness, which begins with these Australopithecine ape men at the beginning, who suddenly see this monolith on the landscape. And the monolith has a wonderful ambiguity about it. We don't know what it is. We don't know what it symbolizes. We just know it doesn't belong there. But it inspires the apes to come up with the idea for the first tool. And the ape uses the bone then to go to war against the other apes, and the tool gives them an edge. And we know how the history then of humanity has turned out since, that whoever has the best tools is going to win the battle. And then eventually, with a cut to the spaceship in outer space going into orbit around the moon, Kubrick situates us into modernity, into the contemporary problem now, that all of this technology that we built initially just to defend ourselves with now has swallowed us alive. We've been swallowed alive inside the very exoskeleton that we designed to protect ourselves against nature with. It now is dictating to us, because the systems, these vast technological bureaucratic systems, dictate to us how to behave within them. And so the machine, we've lost control of the machine, and it is now an authoritarian presence in our lives. And 2000, that whole sequence is symbolized in the scene with HAL 9000 when he goes crazy. And it's almost as though it's already dramatizing the later coming of, in James Cameron's films with the Terminator robot, or in David Cronenberg's film The Fly, when the machine that he does the experiment with messes everything up. And it's the problem with the machine. It dictates to us. And so that film gives us a wonderful myth of the machine, I think.
Do you believe that this technocracy that we're sort of emerging into is evil?
I don't think it's evil, no. I think that the problem is that technology itself is not something either good or bad. We can't then revert to the cliche that people say, well, it's just how you use it, right? And the common example would be something like television, where if all television was like PBS, it would be a great medium. But the problem with that is that it exhibits a certain naivete in the fact that we don't use technology anymore. It uses us. And when we design a machine, especially these modern machines, which when we design them through, because of mass reproduction, they immediately surround us and encompass us and become a total surround. They become a complete, total environment. And the machines have, they're designed to do certain things, and they dictate on us their functions such that we have little choice. Once they're up and running and geared, we have very little choice but to go along with the system that's been prefabricated. The design of our cities, for example, with the coming of the automobile completely restructured the modern megalopolis, decentralized it, created the suburb, pulled it apart elastically with urban sprawl, and basically destroyed communities and neighborhoods. This was Jane Jacobs' great thing. Destroyed communities and neighborhoods in a sense that, that you could walk down the street, say hi to 10 friends, go up, get your coffee. Now when you have to get into a car, you're absolutely isolated from everyone else. Everyone else becomes an it, an other, that you're in constant competition with. Road rage comes into being. And the whole thing becomes a very unpleasant environment in which the pedestrian, for example, is gone. Pedestrians are a thing of the past in most of the cities in North America. They've just disappeared, which, to the ancient world, that would have been regarded as a horror. A city without pedestrians, that's a nightmare. So I think that it's a bit naive to regard technology as something that we can invent and then choose to use it for good or bad. It doesn't really work that way. The machine dictates its program to us.
Because everything is a result of the technology.
Exactly right. And the technology has a certain collection of possibilities that it makes possible. And once the big corporations especially put it into mass production, we're surrounded and encompassed by it. And we don't have any choice but either to go along with it or drop out and do what the Unabomber did, go to a cabin in the woods and send bombs to people to try to blow it up. I mean, those tend to be the choices that we're left with.
With the internet, you know, talking to people has never been easier. So, you know, the average person is going to say, hey, wait a second, technology, there's never been anything better. You know, through Skype, you can talk to somebody from across the world. So how is it that we're farther apart now than we've ever been when we have things like the internet, which is the fastest car that's ever been invented?
Yeah. Well, at first glance, that appears to be the case. Because every new machine comes along, it has a fish hook with a bait on it that says, this will make this way of life instantly easier and more accessible. For example, let's take back in the 1920s when we got all of these appliances. Few people know this, but all the kitchen appliances came into being in the 1920s. The electric fan, the dishwasher, the refrigerator, the kitchen sink. And they obsolesced. They got rid of the idea of the necessity of having a servant in the house, for those who could afford them anyway, doing their chores for them. And so the housewife became surrounded and encompassed by all these utensils now that opened up all these wonderful new possibilities where she could do everything herself. But before too long, it becomes evident that she has become a prisoner of this new environment where now she ends up having to do more work than ever before because the cost and consequences of the new possibilities opened up by the gadgets slowly catch up, inevitably. So there's always a Faustian bargain every time these new technologies come along. Neil Postman, who's one of my favorite media theoreticians, used to always say that, you know, every time a new technology comes along, it makes new things possible, but it simultaneously renders old ways of life obsolete. It undoes some aspect of the culture, destroys it. And the loss may not be a good thing. Usually, I don't think it is. The internet has come along and it's made possible. It's a wonderful medium. I use it all the time. I've become scarily dependent on it now. Whenever my computer freezes or malfunctions, I go into a nervous frenzy, wondering what I'm going to do. So, in other words, I've become captured by it. I'm already a servo mechanism of the internet. It's already running my life now. So I think we have to realize that the costs of what new technologies do may not always be something that we realize are going to be the consequences, but there always is consequences, and they are not always good ones. They tend to be culturally destructive.
We're going to take a quick break. We're with John David Ebert. We're back here with John David Ebert. John, we've talked about the internet and the vehicle and the, you know, these superhighways have actually disassociated us from one another. You know, I live in a big city, and we all live close together like sardines, and I don't even know my neighbor. So is technology, the internet, the can opener, which, you know, made things harder for the housewife, is this eroding society? Should we be moving away from technology?
I think it is eroding society, I especially culture. If we define society and meaning culture in terms of the, you know, the higher sense of authentically made things that have, you know, that have been made with loving care and concern, you know, those days are over. All that stuff is gone. And art as something well made, and you know, that the days when culture meant something, that you created something permanent and to last, all that's gone. And because of our mass production, high metabolism, late capitalism, it has accelerated everything so fast, nothing is produced to last anymore. So it does efface and dissolve culture. It sort of rots it from within. However, the question, you know, that you ask is that should we do away with it? And the answer is no, we can't. Even if it were the case that we should do away with it, it's no longer possible to do away with it because we have created the most complicated and technologically dependent society upon the planet that there's no getting out of it now. We're on the ride at the amusement park, and we're going to have to ride through the whole thing and get to the end to see what happens. Because, you know, part of the problem is all the great civilizations, if you look, step back from them, they all have something that they're good at. Like, for example, Hindu civilization, its specialty was spirituality. And consequently, they have the most intensely developed spirituality in the world, out of all the high civilizations, because that was their thing. Egypt, it was the technology associated with the afterlife, and they spent the entire civilization building and thinking about the afterlife, and all of their arts and all of their literature was inspired out of a meditation on the afterlife. That's what they did. That was their thing. With North Atlantic and American civilization, it's been the machine. That's what we're good at. That's what fascinated us, and that's our thing. So it's not something, you know, that we can give up or that we can stop or let go of, even if we wanted to. But I do think, though, that it's necessary that we should bring in a little more hesitation, a little more critical reflection every time a new gadget is put out there. I think we need to ask ourselves, you know, each device solves a problem, or should ideally, if it's useful, solve a problem. We need to ask ourselves the question, what is the problem that this machine is solving? And is it a necessary solution? If not, maybe we should, you know, engage in a little more critical debate than we do about whether we need these things. And I think it's just necessary that if we don't think critically, Marshall McLuhan used to say that the process of escaping this is to escape into understanding. You release technology from its charm of controlling you by understanding it. And when you step back from it and understand what it is and why it's doing what it is, then you can attain a certain degree of inward freedom from it and not let it just sweep you along off your feet like a tsunami that has come along. So I think we just need to, there needs to be a little more caution, I think. Even though in saying that, I don't think that's ever going to happen. You know, in my own case, I'm always the last guy on the block to get the new gadget. You know, I didn't get the internet until I think it was 1999 or 2000, when it had already been up and running and everybody had it, because I was used to writing my books on my old IBM Selectric. I didn't want to get on the internet, but, you know, it became tempting, you know, when writing these manuscripts and sending them through email became, you know, the new temptation. It's so much easier. You save on the postage. So I made the conversion. And then I didn't get a cell phone until I got into a marriage, and, you know, your wife wants to know where you're at any given time, so I had to get a cell phone. Yeah. I've always dragged my feet all along about this. But that said, I do find these gadgets fascinating. It's not as though I'm saying we should junk them or trash them or throw them out. I do find them fascinating. I love the internet. I love YouTube especially. I think it's absolutely brilliant. It's one of the greatest creations, one of the greatest creations in the history of technology, in my opinion. I think it's fabulous. So I do use this stuff like everybody else does, and I do enjoy it, and I'm enthusiastic about it. But I'm also very skeptical of a lot of it. A lot of it's just junk.
Built to break. Yeah.
Yes.
An underlying theme in your work is that through the course of history, there are these ebbs and flows. There are periods of renaissance, and then there are dark ages. Are we entering into a new dark age? I know that you think that society is dumbing down.
Yeah, I think we are entering into a new dark age. I think it's the thing about civilization is that when we look back over history, every single one of the civilizations has eventually slid down into a dark age by one means or another. In some cases, it might be that the civilization in question is conquered by another civilization. As, for example, let's say the Ottoman Empire conquered the Byzantine Empire, and basically provided them with a universal state. Or the Mughals conquered India and provided them with a universal state. But in most cases, as in the case of the Greeks and the Romans, the civilization rotted from within, was invaded by the barbarians, and there was a gradual turn away from learning and literacy and the mind to, with the rise of Christianity, simple belief and faith, and there became a disdain for learning and the intellect, and people stopped reading. I think what our version of a dark age is the slide into an electronic dark age in which books are slowly becoming a thing of the past, in which you can't get people, professors, you know, I have some friends who are professors who complain that they can't get their students to read anything that's a full-length book. They only want to read, you know, a chapter. They want to get by with the minimum amount of effort. And they're sitting in classroom, and their attention is diverted by all these gadgets and text messaging, and they can't write in complete sentences. They write a paragraph which represents a complete thought, then the next paragraph doesn't seem to connect thematically to the one that they wrote before. And you can sort of tell where they've interacted with a gadget in between the writing of those paragraphs. I think, though, the electronic technology is effacing all the old Gutenbergian values, and it's creating a kind of new dark age where people just don't read anymore because we have so much of the feeling that our reading is already done for us by these gadgets. You know, if you want to learn something, you go onto YouTube, pull up a video, and they tell you how to do it. Why go out and buy a how-to book? So I think literacy is on the wane, even though it appears that, you know, the publishing industry is booming, and we've never in history had this many literate people together on the stage. But the quality of the literacy is very, very poor. It's shoddy. It's basically the sort of, you know, the Oprah talk show mentality, and there's very little thought or critical intellect or any kind of literacy about what's going on in the world in the real sense. The average person just hasn't a clue and gets all their information from these little tiny sound bites that zip past them on CNN. You just don't learn or absorb anything that way.
Is so, this not just evolution? I mean, it used to be with, you know, with the Epic of Gilgamesh, that story was passed on through the spoken word. And then people started to write it down. We talked about this earlier. Are we perhaps just moving into a new medium?
It's very possible, but it's looked at from the perspective of an individual such as myself who's book learned. It looks more like a de-evolution. It looks more like a devolution. You know, oral societies, and every single one of them has evolved from an oral tribal mode where all the myths are sung and recited by bards, and then eventually there comes a point where people start building cities as permanent structures, and at the same time, they start writing the myths down as permanent things to keep in the libraries in these permanent cities. So there's a movement in every case from an oral tribal society to a literate urban one, but it looks to me now like we're becoming not only disliterate and illiterate, but we're also becoming de-urbanized. All these new gadgets are sort of making the city portable. We can carry the city, you know, Marshall McLuhan used to say, even every truck stop cafe with a television and a newspaper is as urban or megalopolitan as Paris and New York. So these new media are making civilization portable. We're carrying it along with us, but it's actually also delocalizing us from these cities, and we're becoming less and less attached to them and more prisoners, nomads of these new technologies that we carry along with us. And it looks to me like a disintegration of all the traditional ideas of culture. Any way that you define the word culture, city, urban, man, all of that stuff looks like to me like it's disintegrating into a kind of tribal, neo-tribal, every man for himself type of society. And I don't see, it doesn't look to me like we have a sense anymore that we're all moving on the same page together, that we're all building something worth keeping and all putting effort into it, you know, the way, say, in the Middle Ages, they would build the cathedral in the center of the town, and everybody would chip in, put some kind of effort into it, because that was permanent. They were erecting a house for eternity in the middle of the city, and it was worth keeping and doing. I don't see anything like that in our society anymore that we're building up. It looks like the whole thing is slowly doing a slow-motion collapse back into a new dark ages.
Through this urbanization, this sort of strips everybody of their culture. And would this not make the people susceptible to control? You know, this provides an opportunity for a whole new culture to emerge.
It does, yeah, very possibly. Part of the problem, though, is that, you know, as far as authoritarian systems, I mean, the culture industry as a whole has already hijacked the population, and they're easy to control through advertising and the mass media and these giant transnational corporations that thrust these products on them and try to convince everyone through advertising that they're basically insufficient unless they buy these products, which act as salves to heal them and make them feel whole, like they're, you know. So we're always made to feel like we're basically fundamentally incomplete, and it becomes easy to control people with this kind of authoritarian advertising via this electronic sensorium that wipes the mind clean. And when the mind is clean, when you haven't been trained to be skeptical or critical about the environment, the social situation that you're in, you become very easy to manipulate and control. Thought viruses, as it were, can propagate, and people get a lot of bad ideas in their heads. And so they become very easy to control. The problem is with shifting into something new is normally there has to be a stimulus for that. There has to be something has to come in, like a catastrophe, like the invasion in Rome. You got all these barbarians coming in, and that swept the stage clean of classical culture for the society then to be remade under the Christian ecclesia, the dome, the world dome of Christianity, could then be built as the new thing that came out of the ruins of the Greek and Roman civilization. So there needs to be some kind of a stimulus that changes our situation in such a way as to make us realize that something new has to come along, or we've basically got no other solution. And what that would be in this case, I don't know. It could be the environment. It could be global warming. It could be the gradual flooding of our cities with rising sea levels.
Yeah, I see it as the worship of Gaia.
Yeah.
As being the new everyman's mythology.
Maybe so. Yes. That's very possible. That would be, at least that would create a sense of reverence and care and concern for the Earth instead of just seeing it as a piece of trash to be thrown out along with everything else.
So I think what we've seen here is that mythology binds us as a culture, as a people. But technology, in fact, separates us. And we're pulled in by the siren call of these conveniences that it allows us. But ultimately, it seems to tear us apart.
And that's exactly right. See, the thing about mythology is that mythology is the basis of all the world religions, and the job of a religion is to hold a society together. It's the glue that holds the society together by creating a system of identity where you can say, I'm a member of this group. And so this, it creates tension with other groups, but it does hold whatever group in question we're talking about. It acts as the social glue that holds them together. The problem then with technology is that very often technology will come along and it drives wedges into these groups. A classic example, I think, is that, in today's society, with industrial civilization, we're constantly asked to give our authority to our fidelity rather to our employers and our bosses rather than our extended family. So because there's this constant pressure on us to go where the employer wants us to go, to do what the employer wants us to do, it drives wedges between the rest of our families, and it puts an enormous amount of pressure on the social bonds between individuals, and very often it can disrupt them. Industrial society is just set up in such a way that it's based on a competition of every individual against every other individual instead of alliance of individuals with each other moving about in groups. That's why we always get the reaction against it is when we get movements like with Occupy Wall Street, and you get this revolt against it. Groups cohere suddenly and they revolt against this. And that the society has gone too far the other way in terms of the directions of individuals pulling the thing apart. So technology does inflict these ruptures on society. It puts great strain on it, and it tends to drive wedges between people. I'm of the opinion, for example, that we wouldn't even need the internet if our automobile hadn't destroyed our cities. If our cities hadn't been decentralized by creating these vast, complicated freeway systems and highway systems that sent us sprawling, hurling away from each other, like the galaxies in orbit flying away from each other, we require the internet now just to connect with each other. I don't think we would even need it if we were still living, say, the way we were living in the 19th century in these, small, quiet communities where everybody knew each other and we could discourse together face to face. So I think the internet is an absolute necessity in a society in which technology is pulling us all away from each other.
We'll go to a break and we'll be back with John David Ebert for our final segment. We're back now with John David Ebert in this final segment. John, in our last segment, you said that YouTube is one of the greatest inventions in the history of mankind, but you're not a fan of everything that's on the internet, and this makes me think about Wikipedia. What do you think about Wikipedia? It allows for quick access to the information about any specific topic, but it's never all that in-depth.
Yeah, I have a chapter on Wikipedia in my new book, The New Media Invasion, as well as a chapter on YouTube and the main sites. But what I say in there about Wikipedia is that, there again, the good thing that it seems to present is that you have this free encyclopedia, because all the other encyclopedias you have to pay for with a subscription. So it offers this free information. You go right on there and you get rapid information about something that you want to know about. The problem with that information is that it's unstable. It creates an unstable database in which supposedly something that is true one minute could be deleted and edited by somebody else, such that what has been true up to just a minute ago is now suddenly no longer true. So it's this unstable knowledge database that we can't rely on, and it for what to tell us what's true, because it changes every second, and it attains more of the status of rumor. It's more of a sense of a sort of public rumor mill than an encyclopedia. And so the knowledge is very poor quality, it's very bad, and it can't really be used to write books about. You can't go to Wikipedia and use that information to build books, or if you do, you have to cross-check it with printed references in other books. So you have to be very careful about it. So it's not a good source for information, but it is a good source for quick information when you've forgotten, you know, what Radiohead's last album was and you want to just go on there real quick and be reminded of it. It works better for that type of information than it does for knowing about Napoleon's campaign against the Russians and what went wrong there.
Well, Winston Smith physically had to cut out the articles from newsprint when he was altering history in 1984. Now they just, you know, delete it there and put in the new piece of information.
Yeah, but as with everything else in the society, it happens so fast that you can't even keep up with it, and it sort of makes a parody out of the idea of knowing anything at all. If what you took the trouble to learn is now obsolete within minutes, why learn anything at all? So we're seeing this rapid acceleration in all these different areas of our society. Paul Virilio is a French philosopher. He talks about this acceleration in our society, what he calls dromology. Dromos from speed. The thing is just speeding up, and the human mind cannot keep up with it. So it involves various defense strategies, one of which is paranoia. You find a lot of paranoia, and paranoid conspiracy theories tend to evolve as a means of the psyche's defense system. Paranoia is a kind of immunological defense system against rapid information overload that the psyche evolves to defend itself against having to adapt to a constantly changing cognitive environment where you're just being bombarded with information. Another possible defense that the psyche has is pattern recognition, and a main form of pattern recognition is, of course, myth formation. So one of the responses is to retreat back into a religious fundamentalism and to simplify and crush all knowledge into a dogmatic authoritarian system that provides all the answers for you, and they're not answers that are going to change anytime soon. So that appeals to a lot of people. So fundamentalism is on the rise, and I think one of the reasons for it, its popularity and its rise on both sides, Christian or Islamic, is that it provides a safe haven for the psyche where you're not just constantly having to change your mind every minute about what's new.
Where do you see the future headed?
I see it headed as a gradual, steady, slow descent into social chaos, anarchy, and disintegration. Everything seems okay now. I mean, other than these wars with Islamic fundamentalists, and really we should point out that we're not at war against Islam. We're at war against Islam's counterculture, because most of these guys are themselves unhappy with the prevailing regimes in Islam. And as in, the Muslim Brotherhood came out of Egypt and Al-Qaeda came out of Saudi Arabia as counter-regimes, counter-cultures to those societies. So we're at war with Islam's counterculture, not with Islam itself. But I think that where we're headed is for ever-worsening wars of this type. These are sort of tribal wars, and we saw the same thing at the end of the Roman Empire with an increase in tribal conflicts and wars amassed along the border. What in those days was called the Limes, which was a big wall that went right through the middle of Europe, and where German barbarians, flooded over it in the 5th century AD and swamped Roman civilization. I think that's basically what we're probably headed for, even though right now we're living in our suburban houses and everything seems calm and quiet and okay. It's a little bit like Europe before World War I, where there was 45 years of peace, and nobody thought, prior to the outbreak of World War I, that, everybody assumed that Europe would be peaceful from here on out, and that it came the end of history, and that was it. I think we're in a similar situation of calm before the storm, basically because I'm a catastrophist, and I see that the major mechanisms that have moved history along, and this goes for evolutionary history as well as human cultural history, they tend to be catastrophes that are the main levers that shift things around.
Well, maybe that's just your way of dealing with the stress of this dumbed-down society.
Yeah, the information overload. That would be my response to it.
That's right.
So take that for what it's worth.
John, let's talk about your new book in a little bit more detail. It's your fourth book, so you're no stranger to the written word. Tell me about the new media invasion.
Well, the new media invasion was, it occurred to me one day, I wondered what Marshall McLuhan, if he was still around, what he would think about all these new gadgets that have, that there's been a major acceleration in electronic gadgetry and technology ever since the internet was turned over to the public domain around 1995. And then along with it, all these gadgets, camcorders and pods and this and that have been more and more capable of interfacing with it. So I wondered what Marshall McLuhan would have had to say about all this. And I thought, well, there isn't anybody around anymore who really has this kind of erudition or sees themselves as a generalist, because most of what's happened to the intellectual world now is also a decline, because we've got, it's been hijacked by the university system, where you've got all these individual professors who are learned and specialized in their areas of expertise, but they don't spend their time looking at how all the pieces of culture fit together to compose a whole, as McLuhan used to do. So I thought I'd better take a crack at it, since nobody else, it doesn't look like anybody else is going to do it. So I sat down to write this book about what all this new media means, what its implications are for us. And I see it as an absolute catastrophe looked at from the point of view of the fact that what we're looking at here is something that we have had to adapt to in the space of only 15 years. And it's hard to believe that it's only been about 15, 20, almost 20 years that we've had to adapt to so many new gadgets. Now we've got the Kindle coming along, replacing the book. We've got YouTube replacing movies. We've got Netflix online replacing Blockbuster. All these stores are closing. Retail stores are closing. Bookstores are closing. Record stores are gone. They're a thing of the past now. So what we're seeing is the internet and these electronic gadgets have catastrophically impacted the culture. It's almost like it's been hit by a meteorite that has shattered it completely and has so rapidly restructured it that we're being asked to give up all these values, Western values such as the printed book and individual literacy and ways of doing and thinking and being that have been around for centuries, ever, at least since the days of Gutenberg, 1500 roughly. AD. And now, in the space of a mere 15 years, we're expected to adapt to all of this, to give up the traditional idea of the book as a printed page, to switch over to the Kindle, to switch over to YouTube, to leave the encyclopedia behind and go to Wikipedia. And it would be one thing, I think, if all these new media were an improvement over these older media, but as with the contrast between Wikipedia and the encyclopedia, I don't think they are much of an improvement. The sole exception possibly being that YouTube has opened up a new window whereby the average person can compete with the corporate monopolization of knowledge and information by putting their own stuff up on that site. I think that's really doing a great service to the individual, and I think the corporations have monopolized too much power in the domain of the arts for too long, and I think YouTube is something that wonderfully runs counter to that. But a lot of it, it's shoddy information, and when you go onto these sites, a lot of them are full of proofreading errors. They're very sloppy. They don't hire people to correct their mistakes and their errors. They don't have enough money on a lot of these sites to pay top quality journalists to do their writing for them, so you end up with a lot of shoddy amateurs and a lot of rumor being passed, a lot of supposed knowledge, which is really just rumor being passed off as knowledge. So it really represents a shoddy situation that the mind now finds itself in. So, I think it's one thing, it's okay if you're aware that what you're looking at on a lot of these sites is something that can't be relied upon and that has to be secondarily checked by traditional printed book information. You have to go and check this stuff out. But it's another thing to think that just because you see a news article on an internet site that it amounts to something or that it is real valid information, because a lot of it just isn't. It'd be one thing if this was a fair trade-off, but I don't think it is. I think it's a knowledge impoverishment and a media impoverishment. And I think we're being asked here, we're being given very little choice to disagree with this. The corporations make up their mind, and they force this stuff upon us, and we have very little choice but to go along and adapt, for better or worse.
Society today is all about the factoid. Twitter, to me, is the worst thing out there.
Yeah.
That's destroying, first of all, the written word. Nobody knows how to write anything down. It's all these abbreviations, FYI, BRB, OMG.
Yeah, that's part of the pressure that, you can't write anything more than 140 characters on Twitter. Who can say anything worth saying in 140 characters?
tell the audience about www.cinemadiscourse.com.
Well, that was a byproduct of my second book, the one on movies, Celluloid Heroes and Mechanical Dragons, that I came up with my friend, the architecture professor John LaBelle. He liked the book a lot, and he thought we should get together and do an electronic version of it that updates, that tracks, takes the same approach and tracks new movies as they come along and write these sort of philosophical reviews about them. Because a lot of times, I think, in a lot of movie reviews, even good reviews, you get good analysis maybe of why a film works and why it doesn't work, why it's entertaining or not, or why this actor is good or isn't, but you don't get much philosophical analysis of what the significance of the messages are, what the themes are in the film, what it's really conveying to us. Because you can only see those with the X-ray vision developed by erudition. You have to read and you have to have knowledge behind you in order to see what these hidden substructures are in these narratives in these films, because they all come encoded with subliminal narratives and messages that most people aren't even aware of when they're watching them. I mean, Star Wars, for example, looks on the face of it at first glance like a giant advertisement for technology. It looks like, you know, it glamorizes it and it looks so beautiful and seductive. But the main theme of the film is how technology captured the soul of this individual, Anakin Skywalker, captured it, ruined him, deformed him, and basically ground him up. And it becomes metaphoric, basically, of what technology is doing to each one of us, actually. And so the problem becomes, how are we going to avoid that fate? How does each one of us come up with an authentic life path that creates decent human values that are not warped and shredded by the machine? How much of our humanity can we salvage without it being hijacked and taken away from us by technology? Is really the main message in Star Wars, but I don't think that a lot of people would realize that that's what they're seeing as they watch it. So that's an example of the type of thing that we talk about on that site.
Well, you know any good movies lately?
Yes, I have. I watch movies all the time, although I haven't been to them lately. The last one I actually physically went out to see was Rise of the Planet of the Apes, which was interesting. You know, it wasn't bad for a prequel. It was well written, I thought, and but part of the problem for me was that it seemed like I'd seen everything in it before somewhere. It didn't seem fresh to me. All of the images seemed recycled. I'd seen them in other films, and it didn't really seem, even though the screenplay was pretty good, it didn't seem to me like I was being introduced to anything that I hadn't encountered before. So it was a little stale, even though it was entertaining.
I thought Andy Serkis' performance in that movie was great.
He was good, yes.
John, I know that you believe that literature is dying. You've written 4 books. We've talked about the new media invasion, but there's also Twilight of the Clockwork God, Celluloid Heroes and Mechanical Dragons, Dead Celebrities, Living Icons. Where do I get these books?
They're all available on Amazon. You can order for all of them there. Just go on there, type my full name in as John David Ebert, and all 4 books will come up.
John, if people want to talk to you about these books, are you open for discussion with people?
Yes, indeed. You can send me an email. I'm at johndavidebert@gmail.com.
John, it's been a pleasure having you on the show. We could probably branch off into a million different directions, and I'd love to have you back on the show at some point down the line and talk about something else.
I've had a great time, Russell. Thanks for having me on.
Thanks a lot, John.